Utopia by Thomas More, narrated by Jowanna Lewis. Utopia by Thomas More. Discourses of Raphael Hifleday of the Best State of a Commonwealth. Henry VIII, the unconquered king of England, a prince adorned with all the virtues that become a great monarch, having some differences of no small consequence with Charles, the most sincere prince of Castile, sent me into Flanders as his ambassador for treating and composing matters between them. I was colleague and champion to that incomparable man, Cuthbert Tonstal, whom the king, with such universal applause, lately made master of the rolls, but of whom I will say nothing, not because I fear that the testimony of a friend will be suspected, but rather because his learning and virtues are too great for me to do them justice, and so well known that they need not my commendations, unless I would, according to the proverb, show the sun with a lantern. Those that were appointed by the prince to treat with us met us at Bruges according to the agreement. They were all worthy men. The Margrave of Bruges was their head, and the chief man among them. But that he was esteemed the wisest, and that spoke for the rest, was George Tmes, the provost of Castile. Both art and nature had concurred to make him eloquent. He was very learned in the law, and, as he had a great capacity, so, by a long practice in affairs, he was very dexterous at unraveling them. After he had several times met, without coming to an agreement, they went to Brussels for some days, to know the prince's pleasure, and, since our business would admit it, I went to Antwerp. While I was there, among many that visited me, there was one that was more acceptable to me than any other, Peter Giles, born at Antwerp, who is a man of great honor and of good rank in his town, though less than he deserves. For I do not know if there be anywhere to be found a more learned and a better bred young man. For as he is both very worthy and a very knowing person, so is he so civil to all men, so particularly kind to his friends, and so full of candor and affection, that there is not, perhaps, above one or two anywhere to be found that is in all respects so perfect a friend. He is extraordinarily modest, there is no artifice in him, and yet no man has more of a prudent simplicity. His conversation was so pleasant and so innocently cheerful that his company in a great measure lessened any longings to go back to my country and to my wife and children, which an absence of 4 months had quickened very much. One day, as I was returning home from Mass at St. Mary's, which is the chief church and the most frequented in any in Antwerp, I saw him, by accident, talking with a stranger who seemed past the flower of his age. His face was tanned, he had a long beard, and his cloak was hanging carelessly about him, so that, by his looks and habit, I concluded he was a seaman. As soon as Peter saw me, he came and saluted me, and I was returning his civility. He took me aside, and pointing to him, with whom he had been discoursing, he said, "Do you see that man?" "I was just thinking to bring him to you," I answered. "He should have been very welcome on your account, and on his own too," replied he. "If he knew the man, for there is none alive that can give so copious an account of unknown nations and countries as he can do, which I know you very much desired." "Then," I said, "I do not guess amiss, for at first sight I took him for a seaman." "But you are much mistaken," he said, "for he has not sailed as a seaman, but as a traveler, or rather a philosopher. This Raphael, who from his family carries the name Hifleday, is not ignorant of the Latin tongue, but is eminently learned in the Greek, having applied himself more particularly to that than the former, because he has given himself much to philosophy, in which he knew that the Romans have left us nothing that is valuable, except what is to be found in Seneca and Cicero. He is Portuguese by birth, and was so desirous of seeing the world that he divided his estate among his brothers, ran the same hazards as Americus Vespucius, and bore a share in three of his four voyages that are now published. Only he did not return with him in his last, but obtained leave from him, almost by force, that he might be one of those 24 who was left at the furthest place at which they touched in their last voyage to New Castile. The leaving him thus did not little gratify one that was more fond of traveling than of returning home to be buried in his own country. For he used often to say that the way to heaven was the same from all places, and he that had no grave had the heavens still over him. Yet this disposition of mine had cost him dear, if God had not been very gracious to him, for after he, with five Castilians, had traveled over many countries, at last, by strange good fortune, he got to Ceylon, and from thence to Calcutta, where he, very happily, found some Portuguese ships, and, beyond all men's expectations, returned to his native country. When Peter had said this to me, I thanked him for his kindness in intending to give me the acquaintance of a man whose conversation he knew would be so acceptable. And upon that, Raphael and I embraced each other. After those civilities were passed, which are usual with strangers among their first meeting, we all went to my house, and entering into the garden, sat down on a green bank and entertained one another in discourse. He told us that when Vespucius had sailed away, he and his companions that stayed behind in New Castile by degrees insulated themselves into the affections of the people of the country, meeting often with them and treating them gently. And at last they not only lived among them without danger, but conversed familiarly with them and got so far into the heart of a prince, whose name and country I have forgot, that he both furnished them plentifully with all things necessary, and also that the conveniences of travel, both boats when they went by water and wagons when they traveled over land, he sent with them a very faithful guide, who was to introduce and recommend them to such other princes as they had a mind to see. And after many days' journey, they came to towns and cities and to commonwealths that were both happily governed and well peopled. Under the equator, and as far on both sides of the sun moves, there lay vast deserts that were parched with the perpetual heat of the sun. The soil was withered, all things looked dismally, and all places were either quite uninhabited or abandoned with wild beasts and serpents. And some few men, that were neither less wild nor less cruel than the beasts themselves. But, as they went further, a new scene opened. All things grew milder, the air less burning, the soil more verdant, and even the beasts were less wild. And, at last, there were nations, towns, and cities that had not only mutual commerce among themselves and with their neighbors, but traded, both by sea and land, to very remote countries. There they found the conveniences of seeing many countries on all hands, for no ship went any voyage into which he had his companions were not very welcome. The first vessels that they saw were flat-bottomed. Their sails were made of reeves and wicker, woven close together. Only some were of leather, but afterwards they found ships made of round keels and canvas sails. And in all respects like our ships, and the seamen understood both astronomy and navigation. We got wonderfully into our favor by showing them the use of a needle, of which till then they were utterly ignorant. They sailed before a great caution, and only in summertime, but now they count all seasons alike, trusting wholly on the lodestone, in which they are, perhaps, more secure than safe. So that there is reason to fear that this discovery, which was thought would prove so much to their advantage, may, by their imprudence, become an occasion of much mischief to them. But it were too long to dwell on all that he told us that he observed in every place. It would be too great a digression from our present purpose. Whatever is necessary to be told concerning these wise and prudent institutions which he observed among civilized nations may perhaps be related by us on a more proper occasion, We asked him many questions concerning all these things, to which he answered very willingly. We made no inquiries after monsters, than which nothing were more common. For everywhere one may hear of ravenous dogs and wolves and cruel man-eaters. But it is not so easy to find states that were well and wisely governed. As he told us of many things that were amiss in those new discovered countries, so he reckoned up not a few things, from which patterns might be taken for correcting the errors of these nations among we live, of which an account may be given, as I've already promised, at some other time, for, at present, I intend only to relate those particulars that he told us, of the manners and laws of the Utopians. But I will begin with an occasion that led us to speak of that commonwealth. After Raphael had discoursed with great judgment on the many errors that were both among us and these nations, had treated of the wise institutions both here and there, and had spoken as distinctly of the customs and government of every nation through which he passed, as he had spent his whole life in it, Peter, being struck with admiration, said, "I wonder, Raphael, how it comes that you enter into no king's service, for I am sure there are none to whom you would not be very acceptable, for your learning and knowledge, both of men and things, in such that you would not only entertain them very pleasantly, but be of great use to them, by the examples you could set before them, and the advices you could give them, and by this means you would both serve your own interest and be of great use to all your friends." "As for my friends," he answered, "I need not much concern, having already done for them all that was incumbent of me. For when I was not only in good health, but fresh and young, I distributed that among my kindred and friends which others do not part with till they are old and sick. When they then unwillingly give that which they can enjoy no longer themselves, I think my friends ought to rest contented in this, and not to expect that for their sakes I should enslave myself to any king whatsoever." "Soft and fair," said Peter. "I do not mean that you should be a slave to any king, but only that you should assist them to be useful to them." "The change of the word," he said, "does not alter the matter." "But term it as you will," replied Peter. "I do not see any other way in which you could be so useful, both in private to your friends and to the public, and by which you can make your own condition happier." "Happier," answered Raphael. "Is that to be compassed in a way so abhorrent of my genius? Now I live as I will, to which I believe few courtiers can pretend, and there are so many that court the favor of great men, that there will be no great loss if they not troubled either with me or with others of my temper." "Upon this," I said, "I perceive, Raphael, that you neither desire wealth nor greatness. And indeed, I value and admire such a man much more than I do of the great men in the world. Yet I think you would do what would well become so generous and philosophical a soul as yours is, if you would apply your time and thoughts to public affairs, even though you may happen to find it a little uneasy to yourself. And this you can never do with such advantage as by being taken into the council of some great prince and putting him on noble and worthy actions, which I know you would do if you were in such a post. For the springs both of good and evil flow from a prince over a whole nation, from a lasting fountain. So much learning as you have, even without practice in affairs, or so great a practice as you have had without any other learning, would render you a very fit counselor to any king whatsoever." "You are doubly mistaken," he said. "Mr. Moore, both in your opinion of me and in the judgment you make of things, for I have not that capacity that you fancy I have. So if I had it, the public would not be one jot the better when I had sacrificed my quiet to it. For most princes apply themselves more to affairs of war than to the useful arts of peace. And in these I neither have any knowledge, nor do I much desire it. They are generally more set on acquiring new kingdoms, right or wrong, than on governing well those they possess. And among the ministers of princes, there are none that are not so wise as to need no assistance, or at least, that do not think themselves so wise that they imagine they need none. and if they court any, it is only those for whom the prince has much personal favor, whom by their fawning and flatteries they endeavor to fix their own interest. And, indeed, nature has so made us, that we all love to be flattered and to please ourselves with our own notions. The old crow loves his young, and the apes her cubs. Now if in such a court, made up of persons who envy all others and only admire themselves, a person should not propose anything that he had either read in history or observed in his travels, the rest would think that the reputation of their wisdom would sink, and that their interests would be much depressed if they could not run it down. And if all other things failed, then they would fly to this, that such or such things pleased our ancestors, and it were well for us if we could but match them. They would set up their rest in such an answer as a sufficient confutation of all that could be said, as if it were a great misfortune that any should be found wiser than his ancestors. But though they willingly let go all the good things that were among those of former ages, yet, if better things are proposed, they cover themselves obstinately with the excuse of reverence to past times. I have met with these proud, morose, and absurd judgments of things in many places, particularly once in England. "Were you ever there?" said I. "Yes, I was," answered he, "and stayed some months there, not long after the rebellion in the West was suppressed, with a great slaughter of the poor people that were engaged in it. I was then much obliged to the Reverend Prelate John Morton, Archbishop of Canterbury, Cardinal and Chancellor of England, a man," he said, "Peter, for Mr. Moore knows well what he is, that was not less venerable for his wisdom and virtues than for the high character he bore. He was of middle stature, not broken with age. His looks begot reverence rather than fear. His conversation was easy, but serious and grave. He sometimes took pleasure to try the force of those that came as suitors to him upon business by speaking sharply, though decently to them, and by that he discovered their spirit and presence of mind, with which he was much delighted when it did not grow up with impudence as bearing a great resemblance to his own temper, and he looked on such persons as the fittest men for affairs. He spoke both gracefully and weightily. He was eminently skilled in the law, had a vast understanding of the prodigious memory, and those excellent talents with which nature had furnished him were improved by study and experience. When I was in England, the king depended much on his counsel, and the government seemed to be chiefly supported by him. For from his youth, he had been all along practiced in affairs, and having passed through many traverses of fortune, he had, with great cost, acquired a vast stock of wisdom, which is not soon lost when it is purchased so dear. One day, when I was dining with him, there happened to be at table one of the English lawyers who took occasion to run out in a high condemnation of the severe execution of justice upon thieves who, as he said, were then hanged so fast that there were sometimes 20 on one gibbet. And upon that, he said, he could not wonder enough how it came to pass that, since so few escaped, there were yet so many thieves left, who were still robbing in all places. Upon this, I, who took the boldness of speaking freely before the cardinal, said, there is no reason to wonder at the matter, since this way of punishing thieves was neither just in itself nor good for the public, for, as the severity was too great, so the remedy was not effectual. Simple theft, not being so great a crime that it ought to cost a man his life, no punishment, how severe soever, being able to restrain those from robbing who cannot find no other way of livelihood. In this, I said, not only you in England, but a great part of the world, emanate some ill matters that are remedied to chastise their scholars than teach them. There are dreadful punishments enacted against thieves, but it were much better to make such good provisions by which every man might be put in a method how to live, and so be preserved from the fatal necessity of stealing and of dying for it. There has always been care taken for that, he said. There are many handicrafts, and there is husbandry by which they may make shift to live. unless they have a greater mind to follow ill courses. That will not serve your turn, said I, for many lose their limbs in civil or foreign wars, as lately in the Cornish Rebellion and some time ago in your wars with France, who, being thus mutilated in the service of their king and country, can no more follow their old trades, and are too old to learn new ones. But since wars are only accidental things and have intervals, let us consider those things that fall out every day. There is a great number of noblemen among you that are themselves as idles as drones, that subsist on other man's labor, on the labor of their tenants, whom, to raise their revenues, they pair to the quick. This, indeed, is the only instance of their frugality, for in all other things they are prodigal, even to the beggaring of themselves. But besides this, they carry about with them a great number of idle fellows, who never learned any part by which they may gain their living. And these, as soon as their lord dies, or they themselves fall sick, are turned out of doors. For your lords are readier to feed idle people than take care of the sick. And often the heir is not able to keep together so great a family as their predecessor did. Now, when the stomachs of those that are turned out the doors grow keen, they rob no less keenly. And what else can they do? For when, by wandering about, they have worn out both their health and their clothes and are tattered and look ghastly, men of quality will not entertain them, and poor men dare not do it, knowing that one who has been bred up in idleness and pleasure, and who is used to walk about with his sword and buckler, despises all the neighborhood with an insolent scorn as far below him, is not fit for the spade to mattock, nor will he serve a poor man for so small a hire and in so low a diet as he can afford to give him. To this he answered, this sort of men ought to be particularly cherished, for in them consists the force of the armies for which we have occasion, since their birth inspires them with a nobler sense of honor than is to be found among tradesmen or plowmen. You may as well say, replied I, that you must cherish thieves on the account of wars, for you will never want the one as long as you have the other. And as robbers prove sometimes gallant soldiers, so soldiers often prove brave robbers. So near an alliance there is between those two sorts of life. But this bad custom, so common among you, of keeping many servants, is not peculiar to this nation. In France there is yet a more pestiferous sort of people, for the whole country is full of soldiers, still kept up in time of peace, if such a state of a nation can be called a peace. And these are kept in pay upon the same account that you plead for those idle retainers about noblemen. This being the maximum of those pretended statesmen, that it is necessary for the public safety to have a good body of veteran soldiers ever in readiness. They think raw men are not be depended on, and they sometimes seek occasions for making war, that they may train up their soldiers in the art of cutting throats or, as Sallust observed, for keeping their hands in use, that they may not grow dull by too long an intermission. But France has learned to its cost how dangerous it is to feed such beasts. The fate of the Romans, Carthaginians, and Syrians, and many other nations and cities, which bore overturned and quite ruined by those standing armies, should make others wiser. And the folly of this maxim of the French appears plainly even from this, that they train soldiers often find your raw men prove too hard for them, of which I will not say much, lest you may think I flatter the English. Every day's experience shows that the mechanics in the towns or the clowns in the country are not afraid of fighting with those idle gentlemen. If they are not disabled by some misfortune in their body or dispirited by extreme want, so that you need not fear that those well-shaped and strong men, for it is only such that noblemen love to keep about them till they spoil them, who now grow feeble with ease and are softened with their effeminate manner of life, would be less fit for action if they were well-bred and well-employed. And it seems very unreasonable that for the prospect of a war, which you need never have, but when you please, you should maintain so many idle men, as will always disturb you in a time of peace, which is never to be more considerate than war. But I do not think that this necessity of stealing arises only from hence. There is another cause for it, more peculiar to England. What is that? Said the cardinal. The increase of pasture, said I, by which your sheep, which are naturally mild and easily kept in order, may be said now to devour men and unpeople, not only villagers, but towns. For wherever it is found that the sheep of any soil yield a softer and richer wool than ordinary, there the nobility and gentry, and even those holy men, the abbots, not contented with the old rents which their farms yielded, nor thinking it enough that they, living at the ease, do no good to the public, resolve to do it hurt instead of good. They stop the course of agriculture, destroying houses and towns, reserving only the churches and enclosed grounds that they may lodge their sheep in them, as if forests and parks had swallowed up too little of the land. Those worthy countrymen turn the best uninhabited places into solitude, for when an insatiable wretch, who is a plague to his country, resolves to enclose many thousand acres of ground, the owners, as well as tenants, are turned out of their possessions by trick or by main force, or, being wavered out by ill usage, they are forced to sell them, by which means those miserable people, both men and women, married and unmarried, old and young, with their poor but numerous families, since country business requires many hands, are forced to change their seats, not knowing whether to go, and they must sell, almost for nothing, their household stuff, which could not bring them much money, even though they might stay for a buyer. When that little money is at an end, for it will be soon spent, what is left for them to do is either to steal, or so to be hanged, God knows how justly, or to go about and beg. And if they do this, they are put in prison as idle vagabonds, while they would willingly work but can find none that will hire them, for there is no more occasion for country labor, to which they have bred. When there is no arable ground left, one shepherd can look after a flock, which will stock an extent of ground that will require many hands if it were to be plowed and reaped. Thus, likewise, in many places raises the price of corn. The price of wool is also so risen that the poor people, who were wont to make cloth, are no more able to buy it. And this, likewise, makes many of them idle. For since the increase of pasture, God has punished the avarice of the owners by a rot among the sheep, which has destroyed vast numbers of them. To us, it might have seemed more just had it fell on the owners themselves. But suppose the sheep should increase ever so much, their price is not likely to fall, since, though they cannot be called monopoly, because they are not engrossed only by one person, yet they are so few hands that these are so rich that as they are not pressed to sell them sooner than they have a mind to it, so they never do it till they have raised the price as high as possible. And on the same account, it is that the other kinds of cattle are so dear, because many villages being pulled down and all country labor being much neglected, there are none who make it their business to breed them. The rich do not breed cattle as they do sheep, but buy them lean and at low prices, and after they have fattened them on their grounds, sell them again at high rates. And I do not think that all the inconveniences this will produce are yet observed. For as they sell their cattle dear, so if they are consumed faster than they are breeding countries from which they are bought can afford them, then the stock must decrease. And this must needs end in great scarcity. And by the means this your island, which seemed as to this particular the happiest in the world, will suffer much by the cursed avarice of few persons. Besides this, The raising of corn makes all people lessen their families as much as they can. And what can those who are dismissed by them do but either beg or rob? And to this, a last man of great mind is much sooner drawn than to the former. Luxury, likewise, breaks in a piece upon you to set forward your poverty and misery. There is an excessive vanity in apparel, and at great cost in diet, and that not in noblemen's families, but even among tradesmen, among the farmers themselves, and among all ranks of persons. You have also many infamous houses, and besides those that are known, the taverns and alehouses are no better. Add to these dice, cards, tables, football, tennis, and quoits, in which money runs fast away. And those that are inhibited into them must, in the conclusion, betake themselves to robbery for a supply. Banish these plagues, and give orders that those who have dispeopled so much soil may either rebuild the villages they have pulled down, or let out their grounds to such as will do it. Restrain these engrossings of the rich, that they are bad almost as monopolies. Leave fewer occasions to idleness. Let agriculture be set up again, and the manufacture of wool be regulated, that so there may be work found for those companies of idle people whom want forces to be thieves, or who now, being idle vagabonds or useless servants, will certainly grow thieves at last. If you do not find a remedy to these evils, it is a vain thing to boast of your severity in punishing theft, which, though it may have the appearance of justice, yet in itself is neither just nor convenient. For if you suffer your people to be ill-educated and their manners to be corrupted from their infancy, and then punish them for those crimes to which their first education disposed them, what else is to be concluded from this but that you make thieves and then punish them? While I was talking thus, the counselor, who was present, had prepared an answer, and had resolved to resume all I had said, according to the formality of debate, in which things are generally repeated more faithfully than they are answered. As if the chief trial to be made were men's memories, "You have talked prettily for a stranger," he said, "having heard of many things among us which you have not been able to consider well. But I will make the whole matter plain to you. I will first repeat in order all that you have said, and then I will show how much your ignorance of our affairs has misled you, and will, in the last place, answer all your arguments. And that I may begin where I promised there were four things." "Hold your peace," said the cardinal. "This will take up much time. Therefore we will, at present, ease you of the trouble of answering, and reserve it to our next meeting, which shall be tomorrow, if Raphael's affairs and yours can admit it." But Raphael said he too, "I would gladly know upon what reason it is that you think theft ought not be punished by death. Would you give way to it? Or do you propose any other punishment that will be more useful to the public? For, since death does not restrain theft, if men thought their lives would be safe, what fear or force could restrain ill men? On the contrary, they would look on the mitigation of the punishment as an invitation to commit more crimes," I answered. "It seems to me a very unjust thing to take away a man's life for a little money, for nothing in the world can be of equal value with a man's life. And if it be said that it is not for the money that one suffers, but for his breaking the law, I must say, extreme justice is an extreme injury. For we ought not to approve those terrible laws that will make the smallest offenses capital, nor of that opinion of the Stoics that makes all crimes equal, as if there were no difference to be made between killing a man and the taking of his purse, between which, if we examine things impartially, there is no likeness nor proportion. God has commanded us not to kill, and shall we kill so easily for a little money? But if one shall say that by that law we are only forbid to kill any except when the laws of the land allow of it. Upon the same grounds, laws may be made, in some cases, to allow of adultery and perjury. For God, having taken from us the right of disposing either of our own or of others' lives, if it is pretended that to mutual consent of men in making laws can authorize manslaughter in cases in which God has given us no example, that it frees people from the obligations of the divine law, and so makes murder a lawful action. What is this, but to give a preference of human laws before the divine? And if this is once admitted, by the same rule of man may, in all other things, put what restrictions they please upon the laws of God. If by the Mosaical law, though it was rough and severe, is being the yoke laid to an obstinate and servile nation, men were only fined and not put to death for theft, we cannot imagine that in this new law of mercy, in which God treats us with the tenderness of a father, he has given us a greater license to cruelty than he did to the Jews. Upon these reasons it is that I think putting thieves to death is not lawful, and it is plain and obvious that it is absurd and of ill consequence to the commonwealth that a thief and a murderer should be equally punished. For if a robber sees that his danger is the same if he is convicted of theft as if he were guilty of murder, this will naturally incite him to kill the person whom otherwise he would only have robbed. Since, if the punishment is the same, there is more security and less danger of discovery when he that can best make it is put out of the way, so that terrifying thieves too much provokes them to cruelty. But as to the question, what more convenient way of punishment can be found, I think it much easier to find out than to invent anything that is worse. Why should we doubt but the way that it was so long in use among the old Romans, who understood so well the arts of government, was very proper for their punishment? They condemned such as they found guilty of great crimes to work their whole lives in quarries, or to dig in mines with chains about them. But the method which I liked best, that which I observed in my travels in Persia, among the Palearites, who are considerable and well-governed people, they pay a yearly tribute to the king of Persia, but in all other respects they are a free nation, and governed by their own laws. They lie far from the sea, and are environed with hills, and being contented with the productions of their own country, which is very fruitful, they have little commerce with any other nation. And as they, according to the genius of their country, have no inclination to enlarge their borders, so their mountains and the pensions they pay to the Persian secure them from all invasions. Thus, they have no wars among them. They live rather conveniently than with splendor, and may be rather called a happy nation than either eminent or famous. For I do not think that they are known so much by name to any but their next neighbors. Those that have found guilty of theft among them are bound to make restitution to the owner, and not, as it is in other places, to the prince, for they reckon that the prince has no more right to the stolen goods than the thief. But if that which was stolen is more in being, then the goods of the thieves are estimated, and restitution being made out of them, the remainder is given to their wives and children, and they themselves are condemned to serve in the public works, but are neither imprisoned or chained, unless there happens to be some extraordinary circumstance in their crime. They go about loose and free, working for the public. If they are idle or backward to work, they are whipped. But if they work hard, they are well used and treated without any mark of reproach. Only the list of them are called always at night, and then they are shut up. They suffer no other uneasiness but this of constant labor. For as they work for the public, so they are well entertained out of public stock, which is done differently in different places. In some places, whatever is bestowed on them is raised by a charitable contribution. And though this way may seem uncertain, yet so merciful are the inclinations of that people that they are plentifully supplied by it. But in other places, public revenues are set aside for them. So there is constant tax or poll money raised for their maintenance. In some places, they are set to no public work, but every private man has occasion to hire workmen, goes to the marketplaces, and hires them of the public, a little lower than would do a free man. If they go lazily about their task, he may quicken them with a whip, but this means there is always some piece of work or other to be done by them, and, besides their livelihood, they earn somewhat still to the public. They all wear a peculiar habit of one certain color, and their hair is cropped little above their ears, and a piece of one of their ears is cut off. Their friends are allowed to give them either meat, drink, or clothes, so they are of their proper color. But it is death, both to the giver and taker. If they give them money, nor it is less penal for any freeman to take money from them upon any account whatsoever. It is also death for any of these slaves, so they are called, to handle arms. Those of every division of the country are distinguished by a peculiar mark, which it is capital for them to lay aside, to go out of their bonds, or to talk with a slave of another jurisdiction. And the very attempt of an escape is no less penal than escape itself. It is death for any other slave to be accessory to it, and if a freeman engages in it, he is condemned to slavery. Those that discover it are rewarded, if a freeman, in money, and if slaves, with liberty, together with a pardon for being accessory to it, so that they might find their account rather in repenting of their engaging in such a design than in persisting in it. These are their laws and rules in relation to robbery, and it is obvious that they are as advantageous as they are mild and gentle. Since vice is not only destroyed and men preserved, but they are treated in such manner as to make them see the necessity of being honest and of employing the rest of their lives in repairing the injuries they had formerly done to society. Nor is there any hazard of their falling back to their old customs, and so little do travelers apprehend mischief from them that they generally make use of them for guides from one jurisdiction to another. For there is nothing left them by which they can rob or be better for it. Since, as they are disarmed, so the very having of money is a sufficient conviction. And as they are certainly punished if discovered, so they cannot hope to escape. For their habit being in all parts of it different from what is commonly worn, they cannot fly away unless they would go naked, and even if their cropped ear would betray them. The only danger to be feared from them is their conspiring against the government, but those of one division and neighborhood can do nothing in any purpose unless a general conspiracy were laid amongst all the slaves of the several jurisdiction, which cannot be done, since they cannot meet or talk together. Nor will any venture on a design where the concealment would be so dangerous and the discovery so profitable. None are quite hopeless of recovering their freedom, since their obedience and patience, and by giving good grounds to believe that they will change their manner of life for the future. They may expect at least to obtain their liberty, and some every year restored it upon their good character that is given of them. When I had related all this, I added that I did not see why such a method might not be followed with more advantage than can ever be expected from that severe justice which the counselor magnified so much. To this he answered that it could never take place in England without endangering the whole nation. As he said this, he shook his head, made some grimaces, and held his peace, while all the company seemed of his opinion, except the cardinal, who said that it is not easy to form a judgment of its success, since it is a method that never yet had been tried. But if, he said, when sentence of death were passed upon a thief, the prince could reprieve him for a while and make the experiment upon him, denying him the privilege of a sanctuary, and then, if it had good effect upon him, it might take place, and, if it did not succeed, the worst would be to execute the sentence on the condemned persons at last. And I do not see, he added, why it would be either unjust inconvenient, or at all dangerous to admit of such a delay. In my opinion, the vagabond ought to be treated in the same manner, against whom, though we had made many laws, yet we have not been able to gain our end. When the cardinal had done, they all commended the notion, though they had despised it when it came from me, but more particularly commended what related to the vagabonds, because it was his own observation. I do not know whether it will be worthwhile to tell you what followed, for it was very ridiculous, but I shall venture at it, for as it is not foreign to this matter, so some good use may be made of it. There was a jester standing by that counterfeited the fool so naturally that he seemed to be really one. The jests which he offered were so cold and dull that we laughed more at him than at them. Yet sometimes he said, as it were by chance, things were not unpleasant, so as to justify the old proverb that he who throws the dice often will sometimes have a lucky hit. When one of the company had said I had taken care of the thieves and the cardinal had taken care of the vagabonds, so that there remained nothing but that some public provision might be made for the poor whom sickness or old age had disabled from labor, leave that to me, said the fool, and I shall take care of them. For there is no sort of people whose sight I abhor more, having been so often vexed with them and with their sad complaints. But as dolefully soever as they have told their tale, they could never prevail so far as to draw one penny from me. For either I had no mind to give them anything, or when I had a mind to do it, I had nothing to give them. And they now know me so well that they will not lose their labor, but let me pass without giving me any trouble, because they hope for nothing, no more in faith, than if I were a priest, but I would have made a law for spending all these beggars to monasteries, the men to the Benedictines, to be made lay brothers, and the women to be nuns. The cardinal smiled and approved of it in jest, but the rest liked it in earnest. There was a divine present who, though he was a grave, morose man, yet he was so pleased with this reflection that he made one of the priests and the monks that he began to play with the fool.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.